And this is the so-called Hamilton-Jacobi formalism. And this rests on the idea to select a very special generating function, which we call S, so that it transforms the Hamiltonian to zero. This sounds like a very funny idea, but let's see where it carries us. So according to our general rule above, this simply means that the Hamiltonian, which we started out with, plus this partial derivative with respect to time should vanish. Or in other words, we have the following condition. Let us first see what we achieve by this. If k is equal to zero, then the new coordinates and the new momenta do not change with time, so they are constants of motion. And the most natural interpretation is that these are actually our initial condition. And this is often what we want to do when we solve differential equation. We want to express our time evolution in terms of the initial condition. Now, how do we obtain this generating function? Well, this actually becomes a relatively complicated but conceptually really instructive equation. So this Hamiltonian is a function of our generalized coordinates and generalized momenta, which can be expressed in terms of these derivatives of the generating function, which is now S, and these generalized coordinates. And in principle, we could have some additional time dependence in here. So this works even with this additional time dependence. This is known as the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. And it looks like a very complicated equation, but it actually has a very particular solution. Namely, this function S here is exactly the action that I introduced above. So it is the integral over the Lagrangian over time from our initial conditions, and as I said, these q's here are our initial conditions, to our final conditions. And furthermore, this Hamilton-Jacobi equation is directly related to the Schrödinger equation in a certain approximation. And this is obtained in the following way. So let me first write down the Schrödinger equation. This following form for a point particle of mass m, but just moving in one spatial dimension, allowing for some potential energy v. And now let us try to find solutions which look similar to a plane wave, even though our particle classically would experience some forces. Now recall that for a plane wave with fixed momentum and energy, according to the rules of Planck and de Broglie, we have the following expression. And let's try to find solutions which have a similar form but are more general in this case. So we have a function of position and time here, and we scale out this factor h bar, which also appears here and here. Now we insert this into this equation and work out the derivatives that appear here according to the chain rule. So we start with the derivative with respect to time. And then according to the chain rule, we get these factors I divided by h bar times the derivative of this function s with respect to time, times the derivative of the exponential function by its generic argument. But this is just the function as we had written it down there. And then if we do the same with respect to position, we obtain very similar expressions. And in the second derivative, we obtain two terms. And again, the factor psi in front of all of this. Now, if we insert this in here, we get the following result. We first of all get from this derivative here, just with multiplication by this constant, minus ds dt times psi. And this is all that we get on the left-hand side. Now on the right-hand side, notice that this h bar squared cancels with this h bar squared. So we get 1 over 2m times the square of this derivative, still multiplied by psi. And before I come to this term, let me look at this term here. And then finally, let's collect this term, which can be written as minus rh bar divided by 2m times this derivative here times psi again. Now the equation that we have written down here is exactly equivalent to the Schrödinger equation, simply expressed in terms of another function s. And in here we can first of all cancel all of these terms psi because they appear everywhere. Now I ordered all these terms here for a very particular reason, because there's only one term which involves h bar. And if you look up h bar, then it is indeed a very small number. So let us assume that we can neglect this term to find a solution which is a very good approximation to an exact solution of the Schrödinger equation. Now this can be a very accurate approximation indeed, and what we do here is known as the so-called semi-classical limit. And what we then see is that this function s here fulfills the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Because in this formalism, this derivative here is simply momentum. And so we have expressed the Hamiltonian on this side as a function of positions and these derivatives here. And this is indeed what the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism asks us to do. Now, as I tried to emphasize many times, the purpose of this video is mainly conceptual, to give you some background information about the relation between classical and quantum mechanics. And what you see in particular is that this action which appears in classical mechanics seems to play a role in quantum mechanics. This concept of an action seems to play a central role in this connection. Indeed, I mentioned this already in the relation between ray optics and wave optics. And in this context, a surface of constant action would be interpreted as a wavefront. But this analogy runs even deeper. There's a formulation of quantum mechanics due to Richard Feynman, which is known as the path integral formulation, which simply starts from the action of a classical particle and writes down a version of quantum mechanics, which is completely equivalent to the quantum mechanics that we do in this course. Now it is clearly too early to look at this in some detail here. The technical details of this are a bit more involved, and therefore I will come back to this at the end of this course. But the general idea behind Feynman's construction is actually very simple. For this you return to this picture here and say that the probability amplitude for this process to happen from the initial conditions to the final conditions is given by a sum of the following terms, where this is simply the classical action. So this looks like our plane wave-like solutions that we have just discussed. But this sum is not only involving the path taken by a classical particle, but indeed all possible paths between the initial conditions and the final conditions. And now formally, this is known as a path integral. So from this, we would then obtain the probability for this process simply by squaring this amplitude. Now, interestingly, this is very closely related to the idea of Huygens. This is how you pronounce his name in Dutch. Of taking wavefronts and sending spherical waves from the different positions along the wavefront and describe wave propagation in this way. And then if you take the limit of a small wavelength, you can use this idea to derive ray optics. And there you would then simply exploit that the intensity becomes focused on paths which minimize the optical path length. And very similarly, you can start from Feynman's path integral formalism and consider the limit where the Planck's constant is very small, and then arrive at classical mechanics And when you carry out the technical steps, you simply exploit that the classical paths fulfill the principle of least action. Now, many of the things which I explained are mathematically quite abstract, but I really wanted to lay them out in detail so that you know what they are about. But the main message should be that there are relations between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. And in particular, there is a limit in which quantum mechanics reduces to classical mechanics. And this is the limit in which Planck's constant is simply taken to be a very small number. Now, in this limit, essentially the operators which we talked about become numbers, and the Schrödinger equation reduces to a very complicated version of classical mechanics, namely the Hamilton-Jacobi equations. But this is as complicated as it gets in this analogy. There are many other analogies which are much simpler. So we have this Hamiltonian, which is an operator for total energy, and it simply becomes the Hamiltonian from classical mechanics, which is the energy expressed in terms of positions and momenta. And in the technical details, you see that there are many other connections, but you can really look at them as technical details for this course. So there are these Poisson brackets, for instance, and they do have a counterpart, which we will see later in quantum mechanics, which is known as a commutator. And then there is this very central object of an action, which appears indeed in all the three more advanced versions of classical mechanics, in Lagrangian mechanics, Hamilton mechanics, and in the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism. But as Richard Feynman has shown us, we can also base quantum mechanics simply based on this action. We simply have to use it in a more imaginative way. So as I emphasized many times, this video is really for information. It gives you some background and context for the relation between classical mechanics and quantum mechanics. So I encourage you to come back to this video at the end of this course so that you can appreciate how much simpler quantum mechanics can be conceptually compared to classical mechanics.